Hi everyone and welcome. In the previous video, I introduced the Throttle Blaster, a hardware solution for changing the effective frequency of a CPU by using pulse width modulation on the stop clock pin. I used a potentiometer knob to select the frequency, and the frequency showed up on a 7-segment display. Many of you proposed ideas for improving the project, so a big thank you to all of you. In this revision of the project, I try to address many of them. So here is what the project looks like at the moment. It can operate in three modes. The first one uses a rotary encoder with a built-in push button. The first time you install the firmware, you need to configure the CPU frequency. The default is 200 MHz. A long push on the knob enters the CPU frequency configuration mode. By turning the knob right, we select 1200 MHz, which is the frequency of this Athlon CPU. We save the settings with a single push on the knob. Turning the knob cycles over some presets. These presets can be individually configured and tuned with a long push of the knob, but I will show you how this works later. Pushing the knob switches to a manual mode, where you can select the frequency with a step of 1 MHz. The second mode uses a single push button. This is particularly useful for those who don't want to add a knob to their computer case. One could use the existing turbo button, provided that the internal switch is replaced with an actual button, like the one for the reset button. The operation is very similar to the rotary encoder mode. Pushing the button cycles through the presets. Long push lets you configure each preset, just like in rotary mode. Apart from a normal push and a long push, we also support the medium push. This is longer than the normal short push, but shorter than the long push. It registers with around a half second push. This is equivalent to turning the rotary knob in the opposite direction. For convenience, a medium push in presets will get you back to the maximum megahertz. The third mode of operation uses the potentiometer, which can be used in conjunction with a single push button. Turning the potentiometer takes over control and sets the frequency to the specified level. Pushing the button switches back to cycling through presets. Okay, now that I have given you a brief overview of how things work, let me address the question that is in everyone's mind. But can it run Digger? Let's find out. Digger is a PC game from 1983 and is notorious for being time sensitive. It runs best on XT class machines. At the default 1200 MHz, it is way too fast. Let's turn the knob down to 66. Still too fast. Now down to 4, which should be equivalent to 4.77 MHz. As you can see, it is a little too fast in the beginning. But as more of the enemies show up, it gets back to normal speed and it is definitely playable. Now let's check how we can fine-tune this preset. A long push on the rotary switch enters programming mode, and more specifically the frequency selection mode denoted by FRE. While in programming mode, the display is flashing. Turning the knob changes the PWM level. Let's unpause the game to check the different levels. Yeah, anything more than 5 is a bit too fast. Pushing the knob once more switches to PER, which controls the PWM period. This can also affect performance, and we're getting lower performance for larger periods. Both of these options can be used to help you tune the Throttle Blaster to your specific machine. Many of you wanted to know how it works on Windows. Let's try out Grim Fandango on Windows 98.
Sorry for the wait, Mr. Flores. I am ready to take you now.
Take me? Take me where?
Now, now. There's no need to be nervous.
Nervous?
At 133, the audio keeps cutting out in the cinematic.
A little intimidating.
Intimidating? Me? But I'm your friend. My name's Manny Calavera. I'm your new travel agent.
I don't want a new travel agent. I want to go home.
I think this shouldn't happen on an actual 133 MHz Pentium, so my guess is that the preset is a bit optimistic. It is probably equivalent to a 90 MHz Pentium. The actual game works fine though, even at 133.
Buenos dias.
Manny, why aren't you at the poisoning?
What poisoning?
Yeah, the Code 3 gazpacho poisoning that everybody's at but you!
Sorry, sir. I didn't expect... Sales agents usually don't come over to this part of the garage.
Hey, you a driver?
Me?
For completeness, let's try Mike Island once more on Windows 98. And yeah, at 1200 we're getting the divide by zero error. At 33, it works great. Shadows of Darkness is yet another speed-sensitive game. One issue is that the character just walks too fast at maximum speed, but there are also issues with the character's stamina dropping too fast, and even some game crashes caused by the CPU.
The path is dripping with slimy goo. You're having a hard time maintaining your footing on it.
Now let's try to play an MP3 file. At 33, the music is cutting out. At 66, it seems to be working fine. Let's try the frequencies one by one. The 50 seems to be working alright, but the visual effect is not super smooth. I expected that it would require a much higher frequency than that. In this awesome video, CPU Galaxy had experimented with MP3 playback on actual 486 CPUs, and 100 MHz was the minimum frequency required for smooth playback. Anyway, that's all for now. You can find the sources, the schematics and documentation for this project on the Throttle Blaster project page on GitHub. I have also designed a small PCB, but I will release the Gerber files once I have tested it. And as always, thanks for watching and goodbye!